Today I'm gonna share two strategies that are gonna make you win any negotiation. These tips are taken from the book Never Split the Difference, which I've just finished reading. It talks about different strategies that you can use in negotiation, and they are taken straight from his experience as an FBI negotiator, in particular as an hostage negotiator. So I think there is a lot we can learn from this book to use negotiation tips in our daily life. First of all, let's talk about the mindset with which you go in negotiations. The goal of a negotiation is really to learn as much as possible about the other party. You should go with a mindset of really putting yourselves in the other person's world and try to understand their values, what they care about, and learn as much information as possible. This information is something you can use then in your negotiation as a lever to really bring the negotiation to a close and fulfill your objectives, not the ones of the other party. The second thing is the mood. So in a negotiation, you should really be empathetic and always use a default voice of being quite playful and happy, always put a smile on. There are very, very rare cases where you need to let your emotion go and your anger and be assertive. But on, you know, 99% of the cases, you should actually use either a very relaxed voice, it's called the late night DJ voice, or a very playful, cheerful, casual voice. The second thing you should know is that the objective of a negotiation is actually not to get a fast yes, but it's to get a fast no, to get a yes at a later time. Many people think that getting a yes immediately is actually a sign of a good negotiation, but just think what happens when someone calls you on the phone. For example, they're trying to sell you something and they're like, oh, do you use Wi-Fi? Do you watch Netflix? And then of course, each of these questions is only leading up to a yes. There's no way you cannot answer yes to those questions, but then the more you go through the dialogue, the more you feel uncomfortable, so you actually don't feel empowered during this conversation. So the goal of having a fast no is because the no is what makes people feel safe and in control. So once they've said no, they know that they are in control, and so they're, you know, much likely to lower their defenses and then starting the real conversation. So the first strategy the book teaches you is how to say no without saying no. Let's assume that your counterparty has made an offer and you really cannot accept, it's too high, or even you want to bargain a little bit more. So there are different ways you should say no to move the negotiation forward. So the first way is to use calibrated questions, something like, how am I supposed to accept that? Or what are we trying to accomplish here? So never say no straight away, but use how and what questions in order to move the discussion forward. The second way to say no without saying no is to move to non-monetary terms. It's better not to have the entire discussion focused on monetary terms, but to ask what are the things your counterparty can bring into the deal that can maybe be a good offer for you. The third way of saying no is to mention a very high price that someone else may charge. So you could say something like, well, if you were to attend Harvard, this is the price they would charge you for this. Or, you know, if I were to buy a house in this other neighborhood, that's what I would pay for it. This really shows the party a very high anchor and resets a little bit the tone of the negotiation. The second strategy that the book teaches you is how to bargain on anything. And I find this step-by-step approach very helpful. It's called the Ackerman bargaining. It's a step-by-step approach to finally get to the price or to the target value that you want. Of course, you need to flip it if you're talking about not paying a price, but for example, wanting a raise. But this works in both cases. So I'm gonna talk about it in the perspective of paying a price. So the first thing you need to do is actually set your target value. So once you know your target value, so let's assume your target value is 100, then what you wanna do is that you want to start by setting an extreme anchor. And the anchoring effect is an effect whereby the first number that they hear, the first number that they see, becomes the reference point for future evaluations. If you were to set a very, very low price, and what the Ackerman method said is you should set it at 65%, so in this case 65, then your party is likely to adjust to more or less than that, but not move drastically outside of that range. You should use anchoring at your advantage by setting a very, very extreme anchor that is really far from your target so that you're more likely to get to that final objective. So in this case, you should say, oh, the price that I wanna pay is 65. Very likely your party is gonna feel a little bit lost and say like, no, that's not possible. And they're you're gonna start bargaining. Then what you wanna do is that in these exchanges you wanna move to then 85, 95 and 100, okay? So 100 is your target price. So you're gonna try by saying no, so using this way of saying no without saying no, to move the negotiation forward, back and forth, and you're gonna give the impression that you're actually giving away a little bit of that initial price. Notice that we go from a big gap to a smaller gap. So you want to give the impression that you're really, really squeezing the dollars at the end of the negotiation. You're first making a big jump compared to your first offer, which seems a very generous thing to do after your very extreme anchor. So you're giving away, you know, another 20 euros or $20 out of your initial offer. And then little by little, you're gonna start decreasing the difference that you offer. When you're very close to setting a final number, don't choose a round number, but choose a very precise odd number, something like 97.